time to call 911, spiritual 911. Why? Because, well, I have 911 subscribers now, this channel does. And it's a perfect time to, again, call 911 for a spiritual emergency, because we certainly have a spiritual emergency that necessitates getting help from God, actually. And why don't we do this? Guilt. We think if we get help from God, that everyone else will insist, that proves we're inferior, that we decided to just be normal instead of trying to be greater than what we are. And then they think, therefore, this is causing them guilt. This is the cause of their guilt, because you refuse to go along with their plan to be greater than God. So that's why we don't call upon God, actually. We keep thinking, where's God? Why isn't God helping us? Well, we're not calling on God, because they think, oh, I don't want to be the cause. I don't want to cause guilt in others, you know. That makes me bad. It makes me feel guilty that I caused guilt. So it's really nasty. We don't call on God. That is true. We keep trying to work it out ourselves. Actually, when the light comes, that's actually becoming normal. We're going back to being normal. So all this mystical, the light, and you know, just all the wonderful stuff that's been reported throughout history, that's just going back to being normal, what we already are. It's this world that is completely abnormal and bizarre. This is an attempt to be something different than what we are. Okay, and that we believe that this means our will is even greater than God's, to be able to change the will of God. So we do need to call 911. It's a perfect time with the 911 subscribers. Thank everyone for tuning in. This is a spiritual emergency. I'm certainly in a spiritual emergency. There's no question about it. Funny world, I crushed my little finger today with a stone, and I was so, it was hurting so bad, I just had to walk around the truck, and in doing so, when out front, I saw this piece of rebar that was sticking straight towards my tire. If I would have like driven forward to pull out, rebar probably would have gone straight into the tire. So it, certainly that alerted me to a potential disaster there. But it's still hurting like the dickens. I say, well, if you've already done your job and alerted me, why do you have to keep hurting? That's the one part I don't quite get. You know, once we've been warned, I think then why don't need the pain anymore? But it's still got the pain. Funny place here. So we need to flip the guilt script. Flip the guilt script. This is what is holding us. This is what prevents us from asking God for help. God will send his light. God will send his light if we ask. But then everyone in the world will say, "Why? What are you trying to prove? You know, you're regressing. You're going back. You know, you're leaving us. Oh, you're leaving us. You're causing us severe guilt. How terrible! You're going to be the cause of our failure and our guilt." And they lay this awful guilt trip on you, actually. Yes, they do. And so we say, "Oh, I'm sorry. Okay, I'm not going to ask God. I'll keep working on it myself here. Keep failing." And if you don't have the inner light, the true light, what are you going to do? You're going to keep worshiping this external solar, stellar light, electromagnetism, which is what causes us the guilt in the first place. I mean, it just makes it worse. We keep trying to worship electromagnetism, worship our time-space process form, our attempt to generate evidence of our own incapacity, which would mean we're not free. Now we're trying to generate evidence that we're not free. This is what we're doing. This is what this whole electromagnetic situation is. We're trying to generate evidence that we're not free. So we're worshiping. Now here's the confusion that we have. We think that, here's the narrative. We think that God created this universe, this world, created human bodies, put us here and said, "This is my masterpiece, this world, and you are my masterpieces, the human body. And I put you here because it's perfect for you. And therefore, you're going to absolutely love being here. Just love it. I got everything you want, could possibly want here. So there couldn't possibly be any complaints. This is going to be your home forever. You're just going to absolutely love it." And then we feel this feeling like, I really don't like it that much. And then we say, oh my gosh, I'm sinning against God. God's angry at me because I'm supposed to love this naturally, created me to love this world, and I don't love it. So it means I must be sinning against God. Oh my gosh, I must produce sacrifices of stuff that I love and say, here, God, here's a token of how bad I feel about not loving this world. I'm going to sacrifice my prize, a sheep or ram or something. I'll even sacrifice a human or sacrifice something. This is the problem we get into, is we've told ourselves that this is what's supposed to make it, that God made this especially for us to be perfectly happy. And we're not perfectly happy, therefore we conclude we must be sinning against God. In other words, we're going against what God wants for us, going against God's will for us. We must have done some behavior that makes us feel bad. And then out of that springs all these teachings. Now, Jesus teaches differently, actually. In fact, Jesus teaches so differently that I know a lot of people must be thinking that he must be some radical deceiver, radical deceiver in A Course in Miracles and Journey Beyond Words. People must say, well, that's some radical deceiver trying to hide the truth from us. Okay, so let's just look at that. What I found in A Course in Miracles and Journey Beyond Words is that Jesus takes great pains to point out innumerable defense mechanisms that generate confusion in our mind and impair our reason. And in looking at all this and looking at myself in my own mind, I realize, hey, he is pointing out the mechanisms I use to impair my reason. He's making it very, very, very clear, brilliantly clear. So, and after it's now been like, 38 years? 37 years of intense study of this teaching. I'm in a position to say I've tested it out and seen is he. Now, here's the question I ask everyone. If someone were a radical deceiver, and this teaching is so different than the teaching we're used to, either he's a radical deceiver or he's telling the truth. One of the two. He's not wishy-washy. Okay? It is an extraordinary testimony. Would someone who's a radical deceiver take great, great, great loving, compassionate pains to point out the defense mechanisms of confusion that impair our reason to us? Since confusion, obviously, is what covers up truth. When you're confused, you don't know what is true, right? So if you remove the confusion, you're going to have a very clear mind. You're much more likely to know what is true. Okay, so why would a radical deceiver spend inordinate efforts to help us clear out our confusion, get free of confusion, so we have very clear, unimpaired reason, if their goal was to be hide the truth? This is the question I have to ask. And this is the question I've asked as I studied this. I wanted to see. I said, let me give this a chance. Let me give this a chance. This sounds like very promising, actually. So this is the question I have. To conclude that a radical deceiver whose job would be to hide truth from us, why would they take what they're helping us with is to clear up all our confusion? Why would they do that? It doesn't make any sense at all if they're a radical deceiver. So that would be to say that this teaching is a radical deception would be the least likely conclusion that reason could draw. And in fact, you'd say if reason drew that conclusion, you'd have to say this is very impaired reason drawing such a conclusion. Reason impaired by confusion. So, this is why I'm saying this very likely, the most reasonable conclusion is that what Jesus is saying is accurate. It's accurate. And it's extraordinarily different than what we're used to. He says the electromagnetic universe spectrum, what we're engaged with here, is our attempt to generate evidence of our incapacity, of our lack of freedom, to prove that we can change what we are and to separate from God and say, we're different than you, God, we're greater than you. And that this world is an attempt to convince us that we do have the evidence, that we just have to find it and accumulate it and get it. And that perception of the body, that we made the body, we made the world, we made the universe, being spirit. And actually in the Bible they have that right. They say Jesus made this universe, which is correct, meaning spirit, Son of God, made this universe and world. That is true. God, the prime creator, did not make this universe or world, according to Jesus. So, the more that the confusion is dissipated, the better, you know, we're able to see and evaluate, and the less impaired our reason is, the better conclusions we draw. Now, those with impaired reason insist that if everybody has impaired reason, that'll get rid of guilt. And I'd have to say that this is a conclusion that only impaired reason could draw. It's impaired reason that is drawing such a nonsensical conclusion. But we certainly have drawn such a conclusion. Time worshipping, sun worshipping, world worshipping, you know, this is what we believe can get rid of guilt. See, we take this path of worshiping the world because we believe it'll get rid of guilt. And this is a conclusion that impaired reason draws. We believe this because we believe that God created the world, created bodies, that's our identity, created it perfect for us, so we're supposed to be perfectly happy, and that the feeling of sin or guilt, actually feeling of guilt, is that we're falling short of what God expects of us here in this world. And therefore, it's reasonable to conclude, isn't it, that if we just learn to love this world more, then we'll get rid of the guilt, because that's what God's created us for, to love the world. And then, so if we do that, we say, oh, I just totally love the world, it's no problem at all, everything's wonderful, then I won't have any more guilt. That's a reasonable conclusion, but the premise is all messed up, right? So impaired reason does not look at the premise. You know, it can't see the premise. It's all confused about the premise. The rest of the stuff, it can be clear about, and it can be logical about, but it doesn't look at the premise. That's called impaired reason. Whereas unimpaired reason first looks at the premise. Is the premise correct? Because the premise is all important. So what we get caught up in this world is tempting to worship the world, to love the world, and like California, the sunshine state, they call it. And I realized I came to California to try to find a way to worship the world, to love the world, you know, perfectly, to get rid of the guilt. And what better place than California, the sunshine state, you know, with more natural beauty and a better climate than any place in the world here, absolutely. And this is why so many people came to California, and I know I very intensely came here to you know, find the perfect spot, that just the perfect place, and so I could love it, and that would get rid of my guilt, you see. Well, didn't work out. Didn't work. And I've had to see the errors of my ways. Thank God that Jesus came along, because who would have ever thought about this doc, what he's teaching? Who would ever come up with that on their own? Very difficult, to say the least. You could say that God created all this because we are an extension of God. So whatever we work, create, is an extension of God. But you can also say that God is all that is. And that God is impartial, completely impartial. It's not telling us what we have to experience at all. You know, you could say that too, actually. But from a pragmatic standpoint, we are trapped in this guilt trap. And this world is our own imagination, a projection of our own imagination, and to deceive ourselves, really. And we're never going to get free of guilt as long as we believe that we have to worship time, space, process, and form, and that's how to get rid of our guilt. And that we are, that this electromagnetic spectrum is the highest. You see this? Jesus said it's the lowest. In fact, Jesus says it's light frozen down as much as you can possibly freeze it, is what he calls this electromagnetic universe. As much frozen down, as much, as far as you can freeze it down. Okay. This is the electromagnetic universe. And we froze it down that far, asked light to do this for us, so we could believe that this is evidence of our own lack of freedom, or evidence of our lack of freedom. So we're trying to generate false evidence here. Trying to generate false evidence. So, being an enormous sun worshiper, actually, I have to say that I felt I needed to find the perfect day, the perfect climate, the perfect place where the sun was just perfect, where everything was perfect, and the plants just. I said, if I could find that, I feel like I'm going to be happy. This is going to cure me. And a lot of people, again, my ancestors came out to California and they thought it was paradise. They said, wow, this is going to cure everything. So many people felt California is the answer, that it's going to cure what ails us. We're going to become actually transformed here. That just living in California is actually going to transform us because of the sun, the incredible climate. I mean, today it's February 3rd, and it's like summer here. I mean, it must be close to 80 degrees. I mean, it's just like an incredibly beautiful day. And I'm just like, wow. I'm just driving along, and it's like radiant spring and blossoms everywhere. And you can see what people have called the Golden State. You know, it's just a land of beauty and sunshine, and nature worshippers come from all over the world, and they think their bodies will be made perfect and healthy and transformed, and guilt will disappear, and they'll be happy, and they'll be role models for the rest of the world, and all this kind of stuff. And this was very, very strong undercurrent to this place. I know that's why I came here. Why I chose to be born here. So this, following this path, it didn't work. It didn't work anything. In fact, things got too weird, very weird, very weird, very weird. You get into this mindset that you just have to do more and more and more and more and more, more flowers. We need, the air needs to be scented with the perfume of flowers. You know, everyone has to wear beautiful clothes. We just have to feel like it's the perfect day in the perfect spot, and this right here is just like, you can't beat this. This is it right here. And then you think that somehow your guilt is going to vanish. Well, it didn't work. So I had to rethink my entire situation, the entire belief system, and that's what I've been doing. And that's why I'm listening to Jesus, because he has a different story, he has a different belief system to talk about. And so I've done my due diligence on that. And yeah, until the light comes, I cannot say for sure. You know, how can you say for 100% sure? But I'm certainly not going to do anything to impair my reason. You know, it's like, oh, well, the light hasn't come. Well, the light hasn't come because that must mean I'm still worshiping time. I'm still worshiping electromagnetism, and out of what, most likely guilt, not wanting to make others look bad or something like that. So, to really listen to what Jesus has to say is quite an ordeal, because it goes flies in the face of what we believe in this world, really. And even what the people say that Jesus taught when he was here 2,000 years ago, it seems to fly in the face of that, but it really doesn't. It really doesn't. There's been a lot of spin put on what Jesus had to say when he came here. A lot of spin. Now, atheists will say, well, there's no God. Well, it's funny. You know, there's no God. God did not create this universe. But then what did? Is the question. And the answer is we did. Spirit did. God the Son, God the Spirit, created this universe. So no one did, you know, no. A lot of half-truths in the world, of people grabbing hold of half a truth and then angry that people don't, you know, accept what they have to say. So I go back again to Jesus being extraordinarily adept at pointing out the various psychological defense mechanisms. Various defense mechanisms are mine. And I just spent, you know, 37 years just looking at these defense mechanisms. And he points out, this is the mind will do this and this and this. And I said, and then I'll see it in my own mind. I say, wow, I see how my mind is working. And Jesus very accurately described exactly what's happening. And so why would someone, an arch deceiver dedicated to hiding the truth, keeping the truth obscure from us, why would they clear up our reasoning so beautifully like that? Doesn't add up at all. That is the least likely equation possible, right? And only severely impaired reason could possibly even think that that's a likely equation. So the best, you know, the what's most reasonable equation is that Jesus is telling us the truth. And he's not trying to hide through, trying to uncover it for us. And that when the light comes, the living light in the beautiful, all what Jesus tells us, the glory that is ours, when that comes to us, that's not making us superior. That's just dropping the effort to be superior and going back to being normal. This is what he tells us, is going back to being normal. Now, just because somebody fails to be superior doesn't mean they're inferior. So those of us have been trying so hard to worship electromagnetism and trying to be superior to God, just because we failed at that doesn't mean that we're inferior. You see, if you fail to be superior, that doesn't make you inferior. It just means you're still normal. You failed to be anything other than normal. That's all it means. So there isn't any guilt like, oh, if we fail, we're going to feel guilty because we're inferior, and you're going to feel guilt because you're superior to us. See, that's another part of the guilt trap, is all this attempt to be superior. They claim, well, if we don't succeed, that means we're going to then be totally inferior to you, and you'll be superior to us, and then you're going to feel guilt for being superior to us. I say, whoa, time out, hold on just a minute here. The fact, if you fail to be superior to what you are, then what are you? You're just normal. You're not inferior to what you are. You're just normal. So everyone will just realize they're just normal, normally perfect. Okay. So we're flipping the script, this guilt script here, and looking at it carefully. Maybe this is our 911, because this guilt script is nasty. Really, but we're getting right into the kitchen right now. We're into the kitchen where everything's cooking, you know. We're seeing what's cooking right now, really. All the guilt that's cooking up in the kitchen. So I believe it's well worth spending time on these tapings, and well worth your time watching this. This is a very key, crucial to your mental health, to your spiritual mind, to your, you know, it's very crucial that you recognize what is and what isn't impaired reasoning, what's really causing guilt, you know, how to really resolve it. All of this is super important. If you don't have the answers to these, you know, you're just going to be continually wandering around, and you'll end up worshiping the world in some way, and, you know, desperately, I got to find some place, I got to find some person, I got to find something, you know, that I can really think is wonderful and great and all this kind of stuff. Wow, rain is coming, supposed to come, California, rain is coming in a couple days, how about that? Pineapple Express is on its way here, so they say. We'll get a little bit, supposed to get about an inch here. But at least, you know, maybe there's hope. You know, we need like about 3 months. You know, we need like 10 storms of, you know, 10 inches each or something. We just need an inundation. Well, maybe we'll get it. I hope we do. Otherwise, you'll be talking about the late great state of California. All sun and no water here, you know? All the sun worshippers come out here and say, we don't want any rain. We want 365 days a year of sun. And this is the attitude. When we get rain, everybody's like, what the heck is this? You know, wow, what happened to my perfect day? We're upset. I know I used to get super upset. I was so into worshiping climate and the sun and the world. Like, if there was a cold, rainy day, I just got depressed. I got very depressed and very upset. And I just refused to believe. I said, this is an anomaly. This will never happen again. Where's my sunshine? And then the sun would come out on a day like this, and I say, you see? Perfect, perfect place. I know this place is going to heal me. I know this place. So I put my faith in California. I said, this place is going to heal my mind. And instead of that, I ended up being in the most incredibly terrible depression and sick, bad immune systems, constant illnesses and viruses and sicknesses. Absolute hell here, actually. An indescribable suffering and misery here in the place that I thought was going to cure me. Such is the destiny of time worshippers, actually. And you get a little crazy. Time worshippers get a little crazy. Absolutely. In one way or the other. They become eccentric because they think this is it. This is it. This is it. I got to do a little more, a little more, a little more, a little more. And you become eccentric, actually. The world is full of eccentricity. It's a bizarre place. And actually doing this sort of taping, and this is like becoming normal again. This is becoming normal again. This is what a normal reason does when the reason sees that it's gotten this guilt problem. Normal, unimpaired reason says, hey, well, we need to look at this, spend time looking at this, and we can resolve this, and you can then, you know, go allow the true light into your awareness and go back on the path of being normal and regain your humor, and you don't have to keep worshiping the electromagnetic realm. And that's what reason will tell you. So it's becoming normal, it's going back to normal as well as the path I'm on. You still see people in California, all over the place. Someone in just shorts, flip flops, no shirt, guy, long hair, on the side of the road with a guitar, just, you know, singing and playing, da 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 da, you know, and because they think that if they just hit it right somehow, boom, they're going to be healed. This is what they believe. So many hippies came out here. Yeah, we're going to catch the vibe. We're going to be the rainbow tribe. This is going to lift us into ecstasy. We're going to hit it. Yeah. Just let the sun. They're out in the sun. Just in the sun. In this, you know, beautiful climate. Playing music. And been there, done that for sure. And thinking that This is it. This song might do it for me. This day, this atmosphere, this climate, this place, the vibe is going to. I'm just going to be healed. Everything's going to be perfect. Or they say everything's going to be totally groovy. Get into a total new groove. And so this is the beliefs that keep popping out of California and going all over the world and other, you know, sun worshipping places and around the world is. You know, we're going to catch this new groove. There's a new groove coming. Like that. A new groove of time worshiping. And the only reason that I decided, you know, gone through this is because I was suffering so terrible, actually. As long as you keep thinking it's working for you, you're not going to stop. So I have so many people here. Rich people, sun worshippers, have, you know, drug problems, all sorts of problems. Their lives become very eccentric. Just look at Hollywood, the eccentricity, the madness of that place, you know. Babylon. over the last couple of years, it has been the best climate in history in California. But I've spent all my time taping, just sitting here taping, not doing anything. That shows you how serious I am about the situation. I realize, hey, you know, there's something cuckoo with the police system you get swept up into in this world, bringing into this world. Something isn't quite right, but it's the guilt blinds us to the answer. See, guilt blinds us to the answer. There's no question about it. And the dynamics of guilt that I've been bringing up in the last several videos, you know, how to flip the guilt script, that is super important, because it's like taking the blinders off. It's like regaining your spiritual eyesight. And then you begin to look at your life and say, oh my God, yeah, I can't believe I was caught up in that. Holy cow. I was always looking to dodge the clouds, you know. I would drive, you know, if there's cloudy, I got to get out of here. I got to go drive where the weather's perfect. And I tried to develop intuition. And actually, I found out your mind is aware of everything. And so I would use that to be aware of, like, where can I go? It was like a cloudy day. Where can I go where there's some sunshine? And I actually became very good at that. Amazing. And I remember once I said, okay, drive to this place about 50, 60 miles away. It was a day, they said, there's no sun anywhere. And I went to some place, and then something, my mind told me, just wait here for 10 minutes. I said, well, you're crazy. I'm crazy and stupid. What am I waiting here for? It's cloudy. He said, no, just wait. And amazingly, the skies cleared up, and there's this beautiful sunshine coming down right in that area. And so I was just there, just hanging out in this gorgeous sunshine. Everywhere else was just, you know, gloomy and terrible. that's how adept I was at trying to find the perfect weather. I found our mind knows every detail. Mind knows every detail of everything. It's amazing. If you really, 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 you know, want to know, you find out that the mind already knows. Already knows. So my main thing was avoiding, dodging the bad weather, dodging anything that somehow was gloomy or bringing me down or something like that. And right now it's like gloomy and cloudy. I'm saying, what happened to the sun? Where's the sun? Oh my gosh. And historically, our ancestors were sun worshippers. Absolutely. This is our history. This is to an extraordinary extent. Extraordinary extent. And in fact, when there was eclipses, they completely freaked out. Solar eclipses. I mean, this just absolutely used to drive the ancients bananas. Because they believe that the sun is God, actually. And so when there's an eclipse, they think there's some power that can get to destroy God, you see. And, you know, they went nuts, sacrifice people, sacrifice. I think the sacrifice was probably to whatever power it is that eclipsed the sun, actually, so that it would be full on the sacrifices of life that we give here and wouldn't eclipse the sun, you see, something like that, actually. There's like some malevolent power that can, you know, snuff out the sun. And so we have to see some way to appease that power so it doesn't block God and snuff out God. You know, it has been a hellacious time in this world. As far as I know, in what we call reality, the light doesn't have a source like a stellar source or anything. The light is just everywhere. It's just self evident light. There's no source like the sun, you know, bringing the light. There's no darkness. There's no darkness. Like, because of the earth turns and the sunlight's not reaching the side that's away from the earth. There's nothing like that. And you might be able to have things dim or something, but not because the light is being blocked somehow. Yeah. Yeah. So Jesus' testimony and message is extraordinary. It is totally radical. And so it's not surprising that people would be kind of like, huh? Suspicious about this. Maybe, what is this? Maybe this is trying to deceive us or something. But again, put it to the test and ask yourself, why would some arch deceiver make it their primary order of business to point out all the clever means we have of deceiving ourselves and confusing ourselves? You see, it wouldn't add up at all. It doesn't add up at all. So that one's a hard one to get around, right? Very much so. Only impaired reason could think it can get around that one. Indeed, it's this world which does nothing to point out our all these defensive devices. In fact, it encourages us, which means it encourages impaired reason, which means it probably is encouraging mistakenness, right? Since we're so confused, we can't even look at the premise. You know, why wouldn't truth want us to look at truth if it was true? If truth, right? There's only lies that want to hide themselves through confusion. Not truth. Truth says, please look at truth. Please look. You'll see that truth is true. Absolutely. I want absolutely clear minds. I don't want any impaired reason. Truth doesn't want impaired reason. It's lies that want impaired reason. And yet, with impaired reason, you're going to draw impaired conclusions, which is what this world certainly does and has been doing. Though it's not an easy path because we don't quite trust what Jesus is saying, because they say, wow, this is just hard to believe, you know, that this is the truth, that all of this, we made it all up, and it's just an attempt to generate false evidence, and we don't need it. We don't need to succeed in finding false evidence because it doesn't exist. It doesn't really exist. Why, how could we need to find what doesn't exist? And that's a made-up need. It's not a real need. So I say, I already know. I already know I've succeeded in realizing I don't need to succeed. I already know I've succeeded in realizing I don't need to succeed. I already know I've succeeded in realizing I don't need to succeed. Meaning I don't need to find false evidence. I don't need to find evidence that I'm not free, because such evidence doesn't exist, in spite of it seeming as if there's a whole universe of evidence, okay? But it's false evidence, actually, because actually we're completely free. We're just choosing to continue to imagine this scenario. But it doesn't mean, just because we're imagining the scenario of false evidence doesn't mean we're not free to imagine something else, right? It doesn't mean that at all. So we are free. We can insist that we're not. This dream insists we're not, but we still are. But it's pretty difficult to determine that, isn't it, if you're insisting that you're not. So you pretty much have to ask yourself, well, what do I really want? Do I want truth or do I want lies? You know, so let's find out which is true, which is lies, and let's put them on the scales, let's weigh them, let's find out. Because something has caused me guilt and a lot of problems, so let's find out what it is, what's causing it. That's obvious. We said, okay, let's try to find out. That's when we start digging into it. But that digging is not easy, that's for sure. It may be simple, but it's not easy, because we got doubts. Because guilt is so, we're so worried, I don't want to mess this one up, I got to get the right answer. And our impaired reasoning keeps telling us, well, Now guilt is coming because we don't feel comfortable in this world. Somehow we're turning our back on this world. Somehow we're turning our back on God. So, you know, that's the problem. We'd say that we just have to learn to embrace this world and every aspect of the time, space, process, and form, and learn to love it more, and that'll really move us in the wrong direction. So, looking at an alternative explanation to guilt is extremely important. At least you can say, hey, you know, if this turns out to be wrong, at least I know what's right, you see. Whereas if you don't have any alternative explanation, you can go into atheism, but that doesn't get rid of the guilt either, does it? Because actually our guilt does come from trying to be separate from God, trying to be greater than God. So for atheism, just say, well, there is no God, and therefore your guilt problem is solved. That does not work either. It does not work. If they said, you know what, I don't think this universe is going to solve your guilt problem, well, that's a different story. Okay, that would be accurate. It is not going to solve our guilt problem. So we do have to get right with God. But how do we do that? You see, here's the question. Is it by this way or that way? So, this is all that Jesus is saying. Take a look at this. With reason. Use your reason. Use reason. And say, is this really true? What is really true here? Use the best reason possible. And give a good hearing to this, flipping the guilt script. What is causing our guilt, actually? And Jesus says, that it's our attempt to be greater than God that's causing the guilt problem. It's not that we're not loving this world, that's not the problem. The problem is we're trying to be greater than God. And loving this world is our attempt to do so, actually. And God did not make bodies, God did not make death, God did not make sickness, God did not make time, or space, or process, or form at all. Did not create any of that. So, we are believing in this because it seems we're searching and seeking evidence of our incapacity, our lack of freedom. Because God created us as perfectly free. So, any change in us has to be to our freedom. That our functioning is freedom. That is us. That is what we are. Freedom. Or freedom itself. So any change in us has to be a change in our freedom. And since we're perfectly free, any change in our freedom has to be that we're less than perfectly free. So we're trying to find evidence of this. So we can say, hey God, we have the evidence. And actually we think this world is the evidence. And we say, God, we have the evidence that we're greater than you. This universe is the evidence. We've got it. So it means we're greater than you. We're going to stay right here. You're not going to take that evidence away from us, you know. We hold on to this evidence and say, you can't have that, God. This is a precious, precious evidence that we're greater than you. See? And we'll die for it, you know. We're going to hold on after our last breath. And again, you have to be humorous about this. Laugh yourself all the way home. Laugh yourself back to normal, actually. Because it is, our attitude is hilarious, actually, if you think about it. They're holding on to this universe and you can't have this, God. This is our proof. How dare you ask? How dare you ask us to relinquish our proof that we're greater than you? We've proven this universe proves we're not free, you see. It proves we're not perfectly free. We're trapped here, God. You see, this is our wonderful proof, and we're never going to give it to you. We're never going to let go of it. We're never going to. And what, you want us to re-examine this? Oh, really? You're trying to trick us, God, aren't you? You think? Because if we do that, you think we're going to find out that the evidence isn't true? Oh, no. You're trying to trick us. We know it's true. And so we refuse, you know, to even look at it. We just take it on faith. Yeah. We got the evidence. It's all taken on faith, you know, that we have the evidence. It's all faith. We haven't even looked at it. We haven't used reason to even look at it. Or we've used severely impaired reason to look at it. So I had, even though I was a sun worshiper, electromagnetic spectrum worshiper. I also had the power of reason, a lot of reason, being able to quietly sift things out in my mind to an extraordinary extent, because I was a composer in a previous life who composed very, very, very complex scores, symphonic scores. And you have to have all the instruments, you know, that are all part of weaving this harmony and melody of all these instruments, all at the right moment, coming in, all this. It requires an enormous ability to very, very patiently, quietly and patiently get everything right in your mind. And when you make a slight mistake, you catch it like this. Wait a minute, I can't have that oboe come in right like that. It's got to, you know. So you're weaving a whole orchestra together to produce some, you know, wall of sound, something people seem to like. And so I was able to do that to an extraordinary extent. And so I had the ability to read what Jesus had to say and keep it in my mind and say, and just look at it, and then look at how everything was playing in my mind and say, and just say, okay, well, what sounds better, this or this? You know, like it's a musical score I'm listening to or something. What sounds better, this or this? And so that way I was able to listen and hear what Jesus has to say, like a great composer. I'm like, I'm going over his score, basically. I'm saying, now, is this right or not? Would I bring the violins? How much, you know, what's the tempo here? What's everything? And you know, all the entire instruments. And I said, huh, he's really very, very good at this composing. And yeah. And so I was sort of like evaluating very carefully how skillful. I said, well, wow, he's incredibly skillful. You know, astonishingly skillful. I said, wait a minute. You know, I said, what's going on here? This is quite extraordinary. And you know, in working on like symphonies, you can work on those for like 10 years, 15 years or something, a long time. It's very complex and difficult. It can be. And so for me to work on A Course in Miracles, for I studied for 15 years very intensely, you know, for me that was like, okay, I can do that. I can do that. It's not a problem. Because I previous life had spent like 15 years on a symphony. So I was like, yeah, I can delay the success of it until I know I got it just right. I've done it before. So that's why I was able to do 15 years of just intense reading and study, reading, study, reading, study, study, reading, study. Evaluate. And then I got to the point where I said, well, this is, you know, this is right, but I just somehow, I couldn't quite, there's some barrier, you know, which is guilt, the guilt trap. And I didn't realize, I was not able to see guilt trap, for how clever it is. And so I went back to sun worshiping at that point for a while. But at the same time, I got A Journey Beyond Words in 1994, by Jesus too. And that really lifted the roof off the whole thing. And I just said, wow. And that was so powerful that I think I had some sort of backlash. And I went back to sun worshiping, like last call at the bar, you know, last call at the bar. Oh my gosh, they're closing down the bar. And it gets finished. And so I just kind of like, so what I did was I worked through the sun worshiping, examined my valuing of the world, and said, is this really worth dying for? And so I went through a long phase there of seeing, is worshiping the world really worth dying for? Is it really that great? And I concluded, nah, it's not really that great. So I did go through a long period of doing that, and then came back to, then started taping and started going back to examining the truth very carefully. Once I had said, you know what, forget all that stuff, forget it, you know, it's not worth it. It's not worth it. So that's, you know, pretty normal, pretty much be expected. Once you realize, hey, maybe this world is completely bogus, then you kind of want to examine, you know, the things you think are most important to you and see, are they really that great? And you re-examine and say, it's really not that great. And then at that point, you're pretty much free to really focus in on the truth. And then you can get to guilt. You can get to this guilt script that we have, which we have now gotten to. even to the point where our friend General Genghis Khan couldn't even get me to buy into the guilt trip. Witness to the most gruesome day in history, our days, and I didn't buy into it. No, I said no. Thanks, General, but no thanks. Nice try. So that means I'm getting to the guilt strip, flipping the guilt strip, getting down to it, and being able to see, wow, this is what's really holding us. We're afraid that somehow we're going to have guilty, but as I said, failure to be superior doesn't equate to inferiority. This is very important. I got there just today. I walked into Ace Hardware, you know, and it's like, oh, or just before I went in or something like that. Yeah, maybe just before. Oh, failure, you know, just before. Oh, failure to succeed, to become superior. Failure to become superior does not equate to inferiority. Therefore, it doesn't equate to guilt at all. So all these people say, if you don't help us become superior, we're going to fail, and you're going to cause us guilt, and then you're going to be superior to us, and you're going to feel the guilt. This is what scares us. It scares the heck out of us. This freezes us up inside. And I just said, whoa, wait a minute, time out here, folks. Failure to be superior, to become superior, does not equate to inferiority. It equates to normalcy. And therefore, they will not be inferior to me. And therefore, I will not have a cause of guilt to be superior to you. You see? So, this is very important, that what we're talking about here. Interesting combination, being an intense sun worshiper, also having tremendous capacity for very abstract, complex reason. Was able to use the reason to see through the mistakes, but not without suffering from those mistakes. That's for sure. That is for sure. And guilt is the linchpin here. We're looking at the linchpin. We're pulling the linchpin away here, so very important. Hopefully that calls 911 to God, says help, you know, help, because really, really could use help, that is for sure. Stop in the wow as we have a moment here. This is, of course, very amazing information here to hear. You don't hear this every day like this. I mean, we're dealing with the universe, God, guilt, freedom, suffering, misery. It's just all just, you know, crystal clear. We're just putting a crystal clear light on this. Failure to become superior does not equate with inferiority, all right? Failure to succeed in becoming superior does not equate to inferiority. Super important to get this. Because if it did, then your failure to go along and try to help everyone become superior to God would mean that you would put yourself in a position of guilt one way or the other. You know, because that means they say, well, then that's going to make us inferior. If we fail, we'll be inferior to you, which means you'll be superior to us, which means you'll have the guilt of being superior to us. You see, so it freezes you up like that. You say, oh, I got to go along with it. Wow. The fear inside us is like this. This is just colossal. Because this conflict, this inner feeling of conflict and guilt is just terrible for us. You know, we just are desperate to escape it somehow. So failure to become superior does not equate to inferiority. It equates to normalcy. Now, I thought eradicated sun worshiping, you know, worship from my system. I still, you know, California just like, wow. But it's way toned down, way toned down. And I pretty much just don't try not to pay attention to the world at all. But, you know, beautiful day, you know, like they just sort of, oh boy, here's another one. And I just, you know, just, okay, let me keep focused on my spiritual, you know, focus here. Yeah, what an irony. I'm living in like probably the best place in the world. I've heard people say they've traveled around the whole world and they say this place right here is the best place in the world. No question about it. And here I am in California, this great sun worshiper in this great place. And I basically spent my whole life, you know, locked up in my room, sick. How's that for like incredible irony? Couldn't even enjoy the place, you know? Really, really funny. You want to have humor, there's some humor right there, really. I mean, for 15 years, I was like in a cave, basically, super sick. And I've really never hardly ever been able to enjoy, and now that I realize the whole thing, I can't enjoy California, you know? I cannot enjoy it anymore. Because I realize, whoa, that's the wrong path. Very much the wrong path. Very much the wrong path, being a pagan sun worshiper. I can't do it anymore. No way. So, you know, you have all these enticements of California right here, you know, Hawaii and stuff. I thought I'd be going to Hawaii all the time. No, haven't been since 1975. And, you know, I lived there for 2 years in Hawaii. And you talk about a nice place too for pagan sun worshippers. There you go, nature worshippers. And never returned since 1975. Where most people I know go to Hawaii every year. Every year. They go to the Yosemite, Sierras, around the world, all over the place. And they go to these beautiful nature spots. This is California. A lot of Californians have a lot of money. I don't, which actually has helped me because I really can't go anywhere. If I had a lot of money, for sure I'd be going to Hawaii. I'd be golfing at the resorts. But now, probably not, actually. Probably not. So not having any money to do anything actually protected me. That is for sure. I mean, see, Californians, you know, the idea is being vibrant. We're here for vibrant health. Not just health, vibrant health. So beautiful bodies, beautiful clothes, you know, just walking like I'm vibrant, you know, and just singing, my whole body just singing a song, you know, singing a song. Of the beauty of this world and of the sun and of this cosmos. And wow, I'm just vibrant. And so that was the ideology. You're supposed to be vibrant here. And what happened with me was just that nervous breakdown trying to be vibrant. It didn't work, you know. I gotta be more vibrant. Gotta produce more beautiful music, more enjoy more everything. You're supposed to be. All the food here is like you go out and pick all the fruit off your trees and juice them up and everything. You're supposed to be like perfect health here. You know, suntanned and everything's perfect here. How can't be sick? In fact, when I got sick, I refused to admit it. I said, I'm in California. I can't get sick. What are you talking about? This can't be here. It's got to be gone. Sun is going to cure it. So I thought the sun would cure my sickness. I'd just get sicker and sicker and sicker. I'd say, no, tomorrow the sun is going to, the climate's going to be perfect. I'm going to be cured. And it didn't work. Got sicker and sicker and sicker and sicker and sicker. Walking pneumonia for years, you know, just refused to admit it, you know, refused to admit it. I said, no, the sun is going to cure me. Just go to the beach, just go somewhere that's nice, the sun beautiful, I'll be cured. Now, there's a lot of different people coming to California now, but back in my time, you know, it was, you know, the elite came here. those searching for the best place in the world to be transformed, to be transcendent, to be vibrant, to be perfect. You know, this had a lot to do with it. And everyone had their nice little house, paradise, their little paradise. Everyone has their, their home. It's still here. And we got no water, and everyone has their lawn is still so green and beautiful, and their tree, everything is still so beautiful here. You know, and the enclaves of paradise, and you know, they're still holding out. Yeah, gotta find it any day now. Today's the day. We get up in California. You know, I say today is the day. Today is the day. I know today is the day. Has to be, right? Gotta be the day. One of these, you get lucky, the perfect day. And I've had times where the day was just so perfect. I said, this is the perfect day. It's gotta be it. This is it. And I was just like, you just hardly can't believe it. You know, the whole landscape scene feels vibrant. And it does feel vibrant. It just feels like vibrant health. And wow, like we're just radiating. But you know, it's all solar magnetism, so electromagnetism. It's all electromagnetism, which, as Jesus said, is our attempt to kill the light. Basically, that's what I say. Kill the light is our attempt to kill our freedom. So electromagnetism is our attempt to kill our freedom, to prove we're not free. That's what it's really about. Yeah, you think, oh, maybe your clothes are just not right. You're not quite in sync with the vibrancy of California. So, you know, you gotta wear these clothes, or maybe these clothes, or maybe these clothes are gonna do it. And then you end up being obsessed about clothes. Like, maybe I'm not wearing the right clothes. You know, what are they wearing? You know, they seem more vibrantly healthy. Then so you start chasing fashion, chasing clothes, chasing how you look. You say, something's wrong. I can't figure out what's wrong. How come I'm not perfectly healthy, more than healthy, and vibrant? And of course, a lot of people came here who felt they would become eternal. Their bodies become eternal, become immortal here. This is the place for the immortals to come to. This is where you get it. Either that or in the Himalayas, some perfect Himalayan valley somewhere, right? Various places around the globe, you know, that people think that too. Oh, it's ideal. You know, Greek islands, Costa Rica, Malta, you know, Canary Islands, I don't know. Ibiza, Goa, you know, places where some nature worshippers go and say, yeah, we're going to get in on the beach of Goa for sure. And it doesn't quite work, then they say, well, where's the ganja, you know? You got to have the ganja in Goa, because to help the process, help the transformational process along here, you know, just give it a little boost. Yeah. I do have to go to the pick someone up, so wonderful. Blessings to everybody. Hope this video has been very helpful. Continue to give it consideration here. We're looking at guilt as the linchpin. Okay, remember, failure to be superior to what we are does not equate to inferiority to what we are. It simply equates to normalcy. We let go of our attempt to be superior. What are we? We just simply are normal. We are what we are. That's all. So there's no generation of guilt whatsoever going on, actually. Unimpaired reason will see that.